I think I may be holding everyone up for lunch, so thank you for sticking around to hear what I've got to say. I have to tell you, though, I have one of the best jobs. My job means that every day I get to look at our company's strategy, what's coming in the future, and where we want to be as part of that future. I then get to work with all of the organisation, all of the teams within our organisation to help align that. The job I do now, though, is not the job that I've always done. I've had a couple of different career turns. I've managed teams in the customer experience world, and I've also worked in human resources, and including a stint in learning and development. And one of the things that I really enjoyed and I became fascinated by in my stint in learning and development was this concept of how we learn from each other, and how those with experience teach those who are up-and-comers, and how reverse mentoring works, how the up-and-comers can actually teach what's happening, the new things that are coming, the technology, the disruption that's happening. I'm based in London, but in case you hadn't picked up from my accent, I'm an Australian. And as an Australian, I grew up in a young country, and we were taught to be very proud of that young country, because it meant that we weren't hampered by history, we weren't weighed down by what had happened in the past, so we could innovate quicker, we could be smarter with how we did it, and we were just all round better. It also meant, there was a term coined by an author named Donald Horne, and he actually meant it in a negative way when he called Australia the lucky country. But in typical Australian fashion, we turned that around and turned it into a positive. And when you think about Australia, it is indeed pretty lucky. We have an abundance of food, we have an abundance of natural resource, we have a very stable political system with very little corruption, we have public healthcare to care for our sick, and all Australians have access to public education and good quality public education. So what that meant is that we have created an infrastructure that allows people to thrive and allows people to develop and innovate. And people who do that in Australia are very much rewarded. And one of the things that brought that home to me was in 1983, when Australia won the America's Cup from the New York Yacht Club, and they broke a winning streak of 132 years in doing that. And they did it by designing a revolutionary keel that was considered at the time to be quite silly and would never work. And in fact, they proved everybody wrong. I've also spent 7 of the last 10 years living in Singapore. And if I thought Australia was a young country, Singapore's even younger. They celebrate 53 years of independence this year. And when they won their independence from the Malaysians, they were desperate to pull themselves out of third world country status. So what they did was they developed a world-class manufacturing industry to attract new business. They started building public housing, and they invested heavily in public education to equip future generations. They also created alliances with bigger economies, countries like Australia, Great Britain, France, countries that they could tap into from an innovation point of view, and from a talent perspective, and they made it easy for talent to come to Singapore and bring those new ideas. They call themselves now the Smart Nation, and as a result of all of this, in just 53 years, Singapore is now considered one of the world's most prosperous nations. The reason I tell you all of this is not to give you a lesson in history, but to demonstrate the point that this idea of innovation being accelerated through enterprise and newcomers or startups happens at all levels. It happens on an individual level, it happens on a business level, and it happens even at a country level. 26 years ago, Colt was a startup. We were born as the City of London Telecom Company. And we came into being through a slew of regulation changes in the United Kingdom that allowed new entrants. 26 years has obviously brought about a lot of change and a lot of growth, but Colt remains unique to this day in that we're still the only original entrant that retains its independence. But to give you some of the stats about who we are and what we do now, we have over 187,000 kilometres worth of fibre access. We connect over 200 cities as well as 25,000 plus buildings directly to our fibre assets in the ground. And we service our customers officially in six different languages. I'm sure there's unofficial support from many of our support people to customers as well in other languages. But 26 years has obviously been a lot of growth and a lot of change. This quote here, I'm sure, is one that people in the room may have seen, but even if you haven't seen it, it's one that should intuitively make sense to people. Because the rate of change is happening much quicker. Technology is changing what we do, and certainly since the Industrial Revolution, it's continued at a pace that we've never seen before in history. Has anyone here in the room heard of Bethlehem Steel? Maybe no one. One person, brilliant. Bethlehem Steel was an American organization that could trace its roots back to 1857. But in that current form of Bethlehem Steel, it started operations in 1904. They were America's second largest producer of steel and its largest shipbuilder. They were declared bankrupt in 2001. And in the wash-up of analysis that business schools over the world will do about Bethlehem Steel and why that happened, they worked out that the management had a penchant for short-term profits. They didn't foresee things like cheaper foreign labour coming in, and they didn't forecast that needs would change, that transportation would move from sea to land and air. They didn't foresee that a country like China could in fact produce steel much quicker and at a much cheaper price. On the other side of the equation, we have a company like Airbnb that I don't think I even need to ask for a show of hands. Airbnb was born by asking one simple question, and that question was why? Why can't an individual rent out their home or a room in their home when it's not being used to people visiting their city or town? Why do we have to be beholden to hotels and motels? And why can't we create a digital platform that helps connect all of those people together so they can easily find each other? Companies like Airbnb that are born in the cloud have a reliance on telecoms companies like Colt in order to exist. They can't exist without telecoms companies. So as a result of that, there's a whole lot of givens, which for you is on the left-hand side of the screen, about what we expect from telecoms companies, and I would argue indeed from any company that provides us with service. We want our information to be secure. We want coverage, we want reliability, we want competitive pricing. And of course, naturally, Colt does provide all of that. But because of this idea of businesses being born in the cloud, there's also a whole lot of new demands that those businesses require. And that includes the speed of response. It includes speed of delivery. It means having a network that can be flexible and that can be flexed up and down on demand, depending on the business need. And it also means they need access to an ecosystem. And Colt provide all of those things as our standard, and then we underpin it with exceptional standard capabilities in customer experience. And that's really important because business now is built on that digital ecosystem. We all have networks and infrastructure, and gaining access to that infrastructure is critically important. Some of it's in data centers, some of it's in the cloud, some of it's managed directly, some of it's managed through system integrators. And gaining access to that in a simple way is critically important to allow a business to get on with what they do best, which is serving their end customer. And the Colt IQ network helps to bring all of those things together to enable business to perform at their best. And now I wanted to go back to the premise, which was how enterprises help startups to accelerate innovation and give you a real-life example of what we're doing at Colt. So at Colt, we're really interested in disruptive and emerging technologies because we don't want to be a Bethlehem Steel. We want to continue to grow into the future. So we're always interested in working with emerging startups. And one of the things that we have is, despite the extent of our network, there is always places where we are not. And it is very common in our industry that we would buy those access services from local providers. And one of the common purchases that we would make is voice minutes. And despite all of the technology, despite everything that's been done, the gathering, the matching, the rating, and the settlement of those voice minutes is still pretty much manual. It still relies on people, for us in India, sitting there matching and sending out those invoices. What we wanted to do was see whether blockchain would in fact help automate that process. The other benefit was that we believed that blockchain would help make it more secure and help reduce fraud, which tends to be a problem in that particular product line. So we partnered with another carrier called PCCW Global, and we connected with a startup named Clear. And Clear have a deep expertise in blockchain technologies. So we asked them to develop this platform, which they did within the space of about 6 weeks, very, very fast for our industry. And we proved that it does actually work. It was so successful that we've gone on to a phase two of that proof of concept. And we're about to launch phase three, where we will bring on four additional carriers to the proof of concept to prove that it works on a multilateral level rather than just a bilateral level. I think the benefits for Cold are pretty obvious. We get access to technical experts that we don't have in-house. We give them free rein to go and do what they do best, and they help us get to a solution much, much quicker. The benefit for the startup is they get access to a vehicle that helps them showcase their capability. They also get access to an ecosystem that they may not necessarily have had, or it would have taken much longer for them to gain access to. In this case, that's a broader range of telco providers that they can then potentially talk to about future opportunities beyond just this one proof of concept. So at Colt, we believe that connectivity does matter. It's really important that how you connect and what you connect with. And we'd love to see you at our booth out there to talk to you about how you too can become better connected, whether you're an enterprise or a startup. Thank you very much.